Hello and welcome to Why Not Mint Money. I'm Deepti Bhaskaran and today I have with me Kapil Mehta, co-founder Securenow.in, who is also our partner with Mint Securenow Mediclaim Ratings. In our previous episodes, we've discussed some of the important parameters that make a good health insurance plan. Today, we'll talk a bit about customer experiences with health insurance and some of the regulatory changes with regards to products and disclosures that can improve the overall experience for customers.
Thanks,
welcome
Deepti.
To the show, Kapil.
Thanks, yeah.
Kapil, as an insurance broker, I'd like you to talk a bit about some of the pain points that customers feel when it comes to buying health insurance or even when they're making a claim.
So Deepti, broadly speaking, there are three important parameters. You look at price, you look at the product features, and you look at the claims. I think all of those have important things which people should consider. On the price, you know what premium you're paying. That's sort of a most basic thing. But what you need to look at how premiums change in the future. Because as you grow older, the premium rates increase and you don't want a very substantial, unrecognized increase in the future. So typically these premiums shoot up at the age of 60 or 65. And so if you're buying it, you should just look at how premiums will look there. So you get into it with your eyes open. So far as product features are concerned, I think my concern there is that there are so many different features which insurers offer that it's easy to get lost in the bells and whistle. Ayurvedic covered, international cover, X, Y, Z, second opinion, all of that. Two things matter the most. The first is that what is the number of years pre-existing conditions are excluded? And the second is there room rent capping? I think look at these two very carefully and then look at others if you want to, but don't miss out on these two features. Claims is a very difficult part of the whole puzzle, but you should certainly look there at the settlement rates, the grievance rates on claims, the time it takes to settle. These are all the various factors to look at.
If you look at the past 1 year, I think the insurance regulator has been proactive when it comes to health insurance. There have been certain reforms, the latest being the whole standardizing of exclusions.
Yes.
How do you think that will help?
The most recent changes are very positive. It may not help so much in customer understanding because I just believe there are limitations to how much a person can understand when they're buying the product. Of course, they should read and be totally aware of it, but it's just such a complicated purchase. Where it will help is that many of the reasons why claims get rejected today are addressed in the new guidelines. So if I can give one example of pre-existing conditions, historically, the way the definition worked is that if you had symptoms of a particular condition, and even if that condition was not diagnosed, the claim could be rejected. The new definition actually does away with that because what it says is that the condition must have been diagnosed for a claim to be rejected. So somebody must have told you in writing that you suffer from an angina problem for the claim to get rejected. So I think the bar for insurers is actually set much higher in rejecting claims for pre-existing conditions. There's another big change, in this, which is around the look-back period of 8 years. So what the guidelines say is that after 8 years, an insurer cannot reject your claim. And it's the equivalent of the three-year period, which is there in life insurance. But if a person is buying health insurance for the long term, because you buy this for life,
that's right.
Then you're going to, after 8 years, you can be rest assured that your claims will get honored. So I think you will see an increase in claim settlement rates.
I also want to talk a bit about disclosures that are out there in the public domain, and especially because we rate health insurance plans, we rate insurance companies on the basis of this disclosure, claims being a classic case. So when we look at claims in our ratings, there are three cuts that we make. One is, you look at claims settled, you look at claims complaints, and then you look at the time taken to settle these complaints.
Yes.
But, the public disclosures are not very neat. Do you want to talk a bit about what changes should happen in these disclosures?
So if you think about the way we do our ratings, claims is roughly one third of the weightage. And in fact, I would argue that it should increase over time. The improvements in the public disclosure can be one of the biggest contributions of the industry and the regulator to the way people buy health insurance. And if you think about the first thing which you said, right, claim settlement rate, which is one of the most fundamental parameters, today it's available at an aggregate level. But when somebody is buying health insurance, what they really want to know is what is the settlement rate for my product.
That's
right. So ideally, you need to have the settlement rate broken down by individual versus group, by the specific product that you're buying, and so on. So you need to have these cuts to make the settlement rate more meaningful. There's the claim grievance rate, I think today the definition of grievances is a bit restrictive, because only written complaints are counted as grievances. And I think that should be broadened to include social media, verbal, spoken, communicated to an agent, so on and so forth, because then you'll really capture all the grievances that are coming into the system. The third aspect is, how long does it take to settle a claim? And if you look at the claim settlement rates, which are published on the disclosures, by and large, you'll see that they're over 95%. They're a high number. But that's not how policyholders feel when they make a claim, because the time seems much longer than the 30 days. And the reason
for that?
Well, that's because the definition says that it's 30 days from the last request made by the insurer. And we looked at some data of about 1,000 claims in our own company. And we found that if I just take the time the person intimated us of a claim and the claim actually got paid on a reimbursement claim, that number is 50% and not like a 95%.
So that's a huge drop from a 95 to 50.
It is. Some problems remain. So claims closed, for example, is a category which should not be there. But when we looked at the ratings this time, there were 6 insurers who actually captured claims closed. And a sort of new variable like that muddies the calculation of what settlement rates are. We also have, for example, another metric which we use is the grievances per 10,000 claims. And that's sort of a fairly straightforward definition. But there are 2 insurers out there who will define it as claim grievances per 10,000 policies, which obviously is a much lower number.
That's right.
And of course, we correct all this. So we sort of look at the calculation and make the changes. But it should not be like that. And I think enforcement on this has to be a little stronger.
So enforcement is still a problem. Coming to now what the ratings mean for customers. A lot of customers find themselves with a plan that's B rated or yes. even C rated. And that's yes. quite down the pecking order mm. of our rating. What should these customers do? If someone, let's say, has a C rated policy,
yes.
How should they look at the health insurance?
Fortunately, the regulations provide the option of portability. And there's been so much of improvement in health insurance products. So if you've got a C rate, somebody's got a C rated product, I would think they need to move up into a B or A rated product, but make sure they do it in a way that they exercise the portability option and they don't lose the benefit of the waiting period that they had. Mm. There are some situations when portability may not be possible. So if a person has developed a health condition after buying the insurance, then a new insurer is unlikely to accept issuing insurance to you. In those cases, hang on to your C-rated products as well, because with the new guidelines, there's a certain minimum standard that all products need to
will
have.
Will now be set.
So mm-hmm. even if it's C-rated, doesn't mean that it's a horrible product. There is a minimum threshold which is there. So hang on to it, but don't be in a situation where you don't have a health insurance.
I think that's all we have time for. Thanks a lot, Kapil,
thank you,
for
Deepti.
Coming here and speaking to us. I hope you enjoyed the episode today. Thanks for watching.